So I'm very pleased to be here. I came here basically to get ideas from the people that are participating in the conference about the status of the big pink elephant in the room, the copyright, and all the obstacles that we're dealing with in trying to overcome something that sometimes feels impossible. And I am not an expert in copyright, even if we have worked on a policy on copyright. This is something I don't think that anybody is an expert on, because we're always getting new challenges to deal with. I think I am coming to copyright primarily as somebody that is an artist, that is a writer, a poet, a politician, somebody that's trying to reform laws in a sort of a way that the rest of you can understand it. And I also own a copyright to my mother's music. She was a famous musician in Iceland. And so I do believe that I have some authority when I speak about copyright reform, because I don't want to own her copyright. I wanted her to get paid more when she was living so that she could make more music. I don't want my children to inherit my copyright. I don't want an extra 70 years on my copyright. I want to be able to live as a writer and get decently paid for it when I'm alive, so that I can create more. And I think that is what most creative people want. Most creative people create not to become billionaires. They create because they have a need to do it. And they do it because they have a need to share it. What's the use of doing something beautiful if you can't, or important or thought-provoking, if you can't share it with anybody? And so I come from a background of being a parent as well, and being having parents myself. And one of the things that I was taught as a child, and one of the things I teach my kid, is that sharing is a noble act. And it is something you will hear throughout society, that sharing is something gracious. However, when you look at the world that we're raising our children in, sharing is now a criminal act. And I was at this really interesting conference with the Icelandic culture ministry that deals with copyright laws, and they are just putting forward new copyright laws in Iceland. And they invited the Pirate Party to speak, I was speaking on behalf of us, and some other people from the ministry, some of the writers of the new Copyright Act. And I asked them, you know, how is it going to be in relation to who I get to share stuff with? You know, I have friends that I have never met. I have friends in different parts of the world that are better friends than some of the physical people around me. And so who gets to determine who are my friends? And they said that they would do it for me. They would determine who is my family and friends. And I tried to explain to them that this is like a... this is the worst type of totalitarianism that you can possibly imagine, when the state decides who gets to be your friends and family. And we live in a world where the definition of family is also very different from what it was when I was growing up. You'd had the nucleus family, but now we have a very multi-dimensional and multi-national family ties. And I think that is important in the context of states determining who you get to share your stuff with. And I find it to be so strange when I think about how the state, for example, and the corporations find it to be okay to keep a log and track of what you're reading and who you share your books with online. So I really don't want to create an online library in Kindle or something like that, because I have a really nice physical library, and if that would vanish one day because Amazon decided to come into my living room and pull them all out because I lent my books to somebody they didn't like, it would make an outrage. But it doesn't if they do it digitally. And I think that the the main problem, the main obstacles that we're faced with today is that I guess most of the people in this room experience sometimes that they are a little bit ahead of their time, that when they try to explain to friends and family and society their reality, most people don't understand them. Now, for example, when, you know, and I'm very often in this sort of bizarre situation where I'm trying to explain to people, you know, why we have to protect our historical records online. And like, they don't understand, what the hell is he talking about? Is he talking about, you know, history about the Romans or, so we have to, and what I mean is that we have to protect in particularly the stories that are news stories, because they're constantly being changed or removed. And so when you think about it, if somebody would ask you to rip out a page from a book, that is very, that is an act that is sort of threatening and you'd feel really pissed off about it. But if somebody removes a page from the internet or changes the text on that page, nobody really notices. And so sometimes corporations and states request that a news story is changed or removed, and then it sort of vanishes out of our historical records. So it's exactly like I would demand that somebody would burn a book in every library in the world at the same time. And that would make everybody really furious and they would do something about it. But because it's so abstract and it's so hard to get people to understand that it's just as serious as if somebody would burn books, we have a huge task ahead of us. And I think the greatest challenge that we have that care about these things is to make relevant stories that resonate with people's cultural norms. And so it is very important to take the geeky language and make it into a sort of a nearly a storybook language. And that is one of the things that I find, for example, Cory Doctorow does really well. He takes these examples and makes them in such a way that we understand that it has a relevance to our day-to-day lives and it is important. So the title of my my talk today is a remix of a sentence from George Orwell, which we used a lot and is still used by WikiLeaks, but we used it a lot when we were publishing the Collateral Murder video. And it says, during controversial times, I'm mixing these two together. So the reference to the, that I had created out of this, during, Corey, help me with this Orwell, during times of universal deceit, telling the truth is a revolutionary act. So I changed it into during times of universal greed, sharing is a revolutionary act. And actually, I was looking at just my Twitter feed this week. And why I say sharing is a revolutionary act is I have so many friends in prison for enabling us to share. Like, the founders of Pirate Bay are all in prison now, and whistleblowers and so forth, and journalists. In the United States last week, and it's been an ongoing thing, but last week, a 90-year-old man committed the crime of giving homeless people food. So even the physical act of giving somebody starving something to eat is a criminal offense. There was a SWAT team that arrested about 30 or 50 barbers for cutting people's hair illegally. And you imagine getting the SWAT team into your room because you are sharing illegally digital stuff or physical stuff. So we live in a world where it's become abnormal to share. And we have to turn this around because I think it is essential, it is in our human nature to share stuff. Be it, you know, food or, you know, books or poetry. Everybody has a poem somewhere stashed away in their drawer and they really want someday to share it with somebody. And I know that because every time I cross the US border, I talk to the border guys always really stressed, you know, if they're going to arrest me or not. But I always say first, like, yeah, I'm a poet. And then they somehow feel that they can talk to me like a human being, and often share that they write poetry themselves. So, and I think we are here to discuss possible solutions to this problem we're faced with. And the reason why I created two startup parties, first I created a party, a political movement in Iceland called, originally it was called Solidarity Coalition of the Grassroots Movements, and we tried to figure out what are the lowest threshold of the stuff that we could agree on. And after the financial collapse in Iceland, we had like millions of little, well, not millions, we were only 300,000 in Iceland, you know, hundreds of people that would sort of meet randomly all over the place to discuss what do we want instead of this. I don't know if you're aware, like, Iceland had the third largest financial collapse in human history because we privatized our banks and they were going to use the money to sort of, you know, into the healthcare system and so forth. Of course, that never happened. Just don't believe them when they tell you that privatization is a good thing, because it's not. Mostly, maybe the idea is noble, I don't know, but the people that usually are in charge of the privatization are not so noble. So what happened in Iceland was really amazing, that they actually got away with it, and this is why I'm a freedom of information enthusiast. They sold three big banks, and we found out in a sort of a parliamentary conducted report about what caused the collapse that they never paid anything, the people that bought two of the banks. They just lent each other for the down payment. And so we never got any money, we only got some debt from them, a massive one. So we didn't only have a financial collapse. We had a collapse that was so fundamentally massive that it really rattled our own belief systems. And it made us realize that everything we put our trust in had failed us. You know, the academia had failed us because they were so interlinked with the people in power, so they didn't dare to criticize. The media failed us because they were owned by the people that owned the banks or the state and were dependent on not criticizing the state, or the state would slash down the budget to them. And the parliament had failed, and the people working there had failed, and just about everything, the financial regulatory system had failed. And so what do you do when you realize that everything you had put your trust in has failed? You have an opportunity to actually transform and change things on a really deep level. But that change has to happen very, very quickly. And it is exactly the same as when you have a personal tragedy. It rattles your belief system. And it is the path for an evolutionary process inside. It is that revolutionary element that makes you evolve into either a better person, better society, or a self-pity person, or, you know, an exploitive society where you exploit your human tragedy to get pity or more power. And so I love crisis. It's my favorite time, because that is the only time we can change stuff. But the people in power in Iceland didn't really realize that during the times of this massive crisis, of course it's the classic stuff, that's why I really don't like political parties, even if I created two. I dissolved one of them and I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm not going to run again. So what happens is this yo-yo element in politics. So you have the right-wing parties and they do all these sort of, they want to free the society and have no rules about nothing, and they go on a huge cocaine trip, and, you know, once you get the power from them, it's like, you know, a house after a very massive party, and the left wing comes in and they clean up all the vomit. And they're very unpopular because they want to put the house in order. And then they lose power and the right wing comes back in. And you know, there are good and bad things that come from both types of running societies. But the worst part is that they're always undoing what the other did. So imagine you're writing a program and you know you have some really good code in between, but instead of using it, they will just throw it away. And it happens all the time, actually, in the code wars. We've had that share of experience with the Pirate Party and various others where people spend so much time bitching about the code instead of actually trying to figure out a solution on overcoming the obstacles in both the codes. So the society never benefits from this rivalry between these polarization of politics. And so the reason why I helped found a Pirate Party was that I felt that we needed to find a new hardware for our system, a new hardware for our failing democracies. And I personally, even if I'm a pragmatic anarchist, I think democracy is the model that most people feel comfortable fitting in. I don't think everybody is willing to put a lot and lot and lot of work into their societies, but people have to understand that living in any form of democracy requires you. Democracy is not a smooth machine that runs without you, because the word just basically says the rule of the people. So we now have democracies, not democracies, because you're not there. Where are the people that are supposed to be participating in the democracy? They expect me to do everything as a representative. And I keep telling them, look, I can't and I won't. And so I want to create a platform for you to be involved. I want you to be aware of what I'm doing. I could be passing some really bad stuff and you wouldn't know it because you think it's enough just to go and vote every 4 years, or not believe in the system at all and do nothing at all, not even create a new system and not voting, which is the worst, and then reap the benefits of the or the hardships of the system that they live in. I personally would very much like to have many, 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 many different types of societies. And I really don't believe that democracy is a model that is one size fits all. I think it is really depends on the culture and the people living in that culture and the traditions. And so I was at this really interesting event in Brussels called the Stateless States, run by an amazing artist called Jonas Stahl. There were people there from all these stateless states, you know, from Kurdistan, from Somaliland, and from West Papua New Guinea, and high-ranking people within their societies. And think about it, like, they have even had, like, in Somaliland, they have even voted for having a democracy and run their system like a democracy, and yet the big UN and, you know, our countries refuse to acknowledge them as states. And so maybe if we start looking at these models, like, I had no idea in Kurdistan, and probably you don't know it, but it is really run as a federate democracy on self-sustainable models run by women, very strong warrior-like women. And who would think about that among those evil Mohadis, Muslims in the middle of nowhere that have been split into many different fragments? And the woman that gave her speech gave me so many good examples on how we can you know, enhance our democracies by having many little models, self-running. I mean, why can't, actually I thought about it would be a good idea that we could allow everybody that wants to exploit others and each other just to live maybe on an island somewhere and exploit each other and just leave the rest of us alone. Be a really nice society. I don't think they want to leave though. I really like the idea of liquid democracy, and it needs to be developed and it needs to be studied. I need studies. If there are any scholars here, or if you know any good scholars, please conduct a study of the pros and cons of liquid democracy. Because I've noticed we had like this incredibly powerful project in Iceland after the collapse that we nearly finished. It was about writing a constitution by and for the people of Iceland. and it really included, it was very inclusive. But what happened when there were like 512 people that ran for the constitutional parliament? Nobody expected so many people to wanting to be a part of it. The people that were elected were known people, like, you know, TV people or people associate trust with something or someone they see often, even if it's not necessarily a trustworthy person or the best person for the job. So I think, you know, it would have probably been better just to randomly select people from the phone registry for that and have them, give them access to experts that could help them with, you know, what you can't do legally and what you should do or how to, you know, execute the idea of what needs to be in a constitution. Now, I have to admit that before the crisis, I did not know our current constitution by heart, and I don't know it by heart now either, because it's written in a very old language, and it is a recycled constitution of Denmark, who were our colonists, and have a very mixed feeling about that. I don't feel it's my constitution. I don't want to have the Danish constitution. I want to have the constitution that the people in Iceland have envisioned and co-created together. I actually, because I was a parliamentarian, I didn't want to interfere, so I say they made a beautiful constitution. And they started it off in an awesome way. So they actually randomly selected people from the National Registry, like 1,000 people, and invited them and paid for them to come to a national assembly where they would discuss what sort of society do we want to be. And in that humble space after the financial collapse, people wanted really beautiful things. The reflection of the nation that I saw there made me really want to be a part of that clan. I think they've forgotten many of these values now. We're sort of back into 2007. But you see what lies deeply inside people during times of crisis. And it's usually beautiful, but it's very easy to exploit it by populists. So we had the National Assembly, we had the Constitutional Parliament, which actually it were very many hurdles. Like the people in power, they won't let go of power. That's rule number one. If you were dealing with mini dictators, they don't want to let go of their power. So what happened to the constitution and the great hope of Iceland leading the way in transformative changes in the world has diminished dramatically because the politicians got hold of it. And so what happens when the people in power, the politician, get hold of it, they killed it. Or actually it's in a coma. The bad news is that people then elected the people that put us in this mess to run the country, which is classic. Left wing, right wing, left wing, right wing, right, left. Left is not very often for long in power in Iceland. Anyway, but people have lost their patience, and that's a good thing. So every time you are in these revolutionary, evolutionary times, you will know that something's right when people do not just take it. And even if they make the mistake of believing the lies, they will have a much shorter fuse. So we had a really good protest last Monday, and there is going to be another one next Monday, and there will probably be protests until we get the constitution, because people are finally realizing that if you don't change your society, fundamentally nothing's going to change. And so the same may apply to when we want to fundamentally change the ideas that we really care about. I don't see the internet as a separate part from like the offline world. I got involved in it in 95. I started to use it as my publishing platform, and I did some live broadcasts, one of the first in the world. You usually have to get the geeks to do the stuff that's impossible. Everybody said, oh, you can't do that, it's not ready, there's no technology. And I said, yes, there will be. And we had some good good try, servers crashing all over the world. But it was, for me, it was a proof that you, like, if you really believe something is going to be ready, it will be eventually. And you see it actually in science fiction books. Anybody that's read Snow Crash by Neil Stephenson know that Google just used it as a user manual to do lots of interesting things, like Google Maps. And they should actually have called it Goggle. or Google Earth, it was Google Earth. And so I think we need the visionaries, the philosophers, I don't think I know, and the artists, the writers, and the visual artists, and the filmmakers, and the musicians, to apply themselves in discussing and starting to draft the future we want. Because the future is not going to happen without your vision. And if you don't know how you want the future to be, there is not going to, those that know what they want, like the people in the, you know, the billion dollar think tanks, they know what they want to do. But we are not applying enough energy into this. And I think it is so important. So I have a little task for you. In the next week, you can start today, start to think about how you would like things to be in 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, 100 years, and see how far you can go. I find it very difficult myself because I believe that I won't see it until I see your fragments infused with mine. And so I want to have this discussion. You know, what is your future vision? Where are we going as humanity? I know I don't want to end up on Mars. I don't want my son to end up on Mars. It's not appealing to me at all. Nor the moon. I want us to be here on this amazing planet. The reason why I fell in love with the internet in 95, you know, imagine living on an island, in the middle of the North Atlantic Ocean with 320,000 people, and everybody speaks an alien Viking language that nobody understands. I don't know if you've ever lived in a village. You're probably not living there anymore. Or you go out of the village to, you know, get some knowledge and get to meet like-minded people. Now, when I plugged into the internet, I all of a sudden was not stuck on an island. I met all these incredible people that were like-minded, wanted to do, you know, all sorts of stuff. But most importantly, they all had the people that I would start to work with. They wanted to be a force of making the future better in one way or another. They all had that aspiration that they wanted to improve things a little bit in our world. And when I created this First Life broadcast on the internet, and I probably violated so many copyrights. Thank God nobody was thinking about that back then. So I created this website that was a countdown to the live broadcast, and it received all these sort of awards you could get online in the old days. You would always be getting like the cool side of the day, which was like the opening, like it was like the front page of the internet back then. So if you were selected the cool side of the day, everybody would go to your site. It was like a massive trend on Twitter or something today, the trend on Twitter. And my website received that honor because I had put all these like video and music clips, and back in 95-96 you can imagine how difficult it was to sort of look at it through dial-up. But it was an attempt to use new technology, like we used Real Audio and See You See Me for the live stuff. But because of, like, I got a lot of recognition for this experiment, I was invited to this event in New York, which was awarding, like, was one of the first awards for doing good stuff online. And I met people, and I'm telling you this because it's all about the spirit of sharing. And I met these people that created a website for orphans. And they told me that that there was children there that never would have stood a chance in the ordinary orphanage to be adopted, because like one of them was blind, African-American with diabetes. And he would just never have stood a chance to be adopted. But when people could actually read it in the comfort or in their homes and read about his backstory, he was adopted. And so I thought the internet can actually improve our offline world so much. It is such an amazing tool to make us better somehow as humanity. And I feel, you know, I go to conferences all the time and I meet people that are really involved deeply in the internet. And you know, I really feel that we cannot give in to the dystopia that is, you know, all around us right now. Because it's still only a tool that we use. It is consistent of us. We're sort of like, it's sort of like the nervous system of humanity. And nobody is going to steal that away from us if we don't only have to not, you know, like the Declaration of Independence of Cyberspace says it all, was written in 96. How many of you read it? Okay, all the other ones that haven't, I shall tweet it with a, like a hashtag to the conference, and please read it. It's written by John Perry Barlow, one of the co-founders of the Electronic Frontier Foundation, a true visionary. And it so applies today, it's incredible, it's sort of chilling how it applies today. And if we would have taken his warrior call for, you know, the internet tribe back then, we'd not be in the mess we're in today. But I think, like, I see those giants that we're dealing with, and it's mostly, you know, this unhealthy marriage between the corporate and state problem that we could solve with more transparency and accountability, but that's an entirely different talk. But I see it like a giant, you know, a really huge giant. And here we are, all with our little needles and pins and little knives, and we can stick it in many, many different places, and eventually it will bleed out. Okay, it's not a very beautiful metaphor, but I sort of see it this way. I'm a bit rough, I know. So, and that is exactly what I notice when I travel around the world and I speak to all these different people that are doing all these amazing initiatives. That if we would somehow interconnect them, and eventually it will actually interconnect, because we're all moving in the same stream. So even if we have NSA, you know, the United States, China, Russia, and all these other elements that have this incredible capacity to destroy our world, our internet world, that will eventually then destroy our capacity to work together globally, we still have a fighting chance. Just like we have a fighting chance when it comes to the environmental problems. But we're really, really running out of time. We're really running out of time, and we really have to apply ourselves. Just like, you know, put 1% or 10%, like Corey mentioned yesterday, into a charity that we feel is important to look after our rights. We also have to apply, it's work now. It's really crunch time. We really have to apply ourselves like 100%, you know, 100% extra job on the job that we're already doing. You know, sorry to say it, but we have to apply ourselves. And I very often speak to people, you know, they come to me and the first thing they say is, see that there is this problem and that problem and blah, blah, blah problem. Problem, problem, problem. It's always been like this, problem, 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 problem. And, you know, I don't give a shit about the problems. Because I know that we also have the capacity to see solutions. And I see so many solutions happening all the time. If we are constantly looking at the problems, problem, 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 problems, we are not going to apply our energy to think of solutions. And I tell you, when I had my first book published, I was blessed, I was so blessed that everybody said no, because I hadn't finished it. You know, and then finally when I got it published, I'm still pleased with it. If it would have been published the first time everybody said no, I'd be sort of embarrassed. So it taught me a very valuable lesson. You know, you always stand up and you don't give up, and you might actually have to look at how you improve the stuff you're doing, how you improve your methods. And it is in the nature of us. a very important nature of human being, which many of us tend to forget, because we're so stuck that our idea is the idea, and the argument of the argument for the argument's sake. That we can always improve, and that is what the internet has really given us, access to infinite knowledge. You know, how many of you have gone to the internet archives? Okay, those who haven't been there, please go there. And please support the Internet Archives, because it's the same place that hosts the Wayback Machine. Like, if you ever made an embarrassing website sometime, it is usually there. and anything else. Like, it was such a beautiful little civil disobedience that Brewster Kyle did, who is the librarian of the world. Like, when WikiLeaks were leaking all this stuff, you know, the cables and the Afghan warlocks and the Iraq warlocks, it was, of course, many attempts to take it down. And nobody in the United States really realized that it was hosted there at the Internet Archives. Or in the Wayback Machine. So you just have to go in the Wayback Machine to see all the different types of WikiLeaks. And when I see that sort of stuff, I know that there is hope, that we can actually overcome this, but we have to really apply every possible skill we have to think, to actually go sideways, because like, that's the only reason I've managed to get stuff through the parliament, and pretty radical stuff. Like when I got the Icelandic Modern Media Initiative through the parliament, I had Julian Assange, Daniel Domscheidberg, Rob Konkrep, Jacob Applebaum, and myself host a workshop inside the Icelandic parliament about this initiative. And we had parliamentarians from every party come. Well, that was before all the drama, but so this was like 2009, early 2010. But it just goes to show that anything is possible. Just the fact that me, of all people in the world, is for the second time with my second party made out of nothing inside a national parliament in any country is an absolutely bizarre thought, at least to myself. And especially because I have never had an aspiration to be there. But many of you might not know, but I went in there, like Richard Stallman, he calls me a hacker. And I was like, first time I said to me, look, I really wish. And he said, well, you're a hacker inside the system, in the physical system. And that's what I am. I am looking inside the system, and what better access to the system than the parliament? Because you have access to every institution. You have a duty to look after what they're up to. And I'm in the oversight committee as well, so I have really good access. And so I go in there and I look at the system and I'm trying to figure out if there are anything wrong inside it. And yeah, there is lots of stuff that's wrong. And what do good hackers do? The white hats, they report if there are any weaknesses in the system. And so that's what I do. And if nobody listens, you're gonna have to wake them up with leaks, like some good hackers do. And I've done that. I didn't leak it though. I did record a very sensitive discussion between all the leaders of the parties when the last session in the parliament last term was happening, and they were all betraying us on the constitution, and I recorded it, and I let the leader of one of these parties, the previous leader, listen to it, because I knew they wouldn't believe me. And now they all get very twitchy and nervous around me. they're always with the recording jokes. It's like, are you recording? I might be recording. it's on my phone, actually, but not very many people have heard it. It's hilarious. The current prime minister, he wasn't prime minister then, the speaker of the house says, like, don't slam the door. And then when I heard that they were going to do like these really horrible things to the constitutional process, I had forgotten I was recording, and I stormed down and I slammed the door so intensely that you can just hear it vibrate on the recording. It is very useful to know what's going on inside. You know, I think it would be super cool. I really don't like Coca-Cola. I really want to buy a share in Coca-Cola so they would have to have me on shareholders meetings. You know, we can do little hacks like this. There are, like, and it's like the creativity that I think is so important to share is within every one of us. Every person is creative, even the person that cooks really good dinners, your mother or something, is very creative when they cook. They know to put love in the food so it tastes better. So you see, like, in nature, it's just one gigantic ball of creativity. And I will do everything in my power to make sure that we get to carry on sharing in every possible way, you know, because there are so many different ways of sharing. There is a beautiful saying, like, if you smile to somebody, you know, that smile will then travel all through the day and eventually might catch up with you 5 years later. And so sharing has many different ways. I mean, next thing they might think of is, you know, smiling to serious bank cashiers is not a good thing because it might make them softer. I think, like, conferences like this are very important. Because, you know, for me, I heard a talk from one of the Brussels hackers yesterday. It's very good to know that there are people everywhere doing exactly the same things that I'm doing. And now I have their wiki page and I can look at that and see if I can hack something out of that or, you know, remix that into the stuff that I'm doing in Iceland. And if that would be maybe the only thing I would take home, it's worth going all over, all the way here. And that is, for me, the beauty of sharing. You know, you don't always know what you're going to be bringing back home. And I am just so thankful that there are so many people like this, you know, everywhere. And I get to meet them because they are such an inspiration. And it is so good, and this is what I actually want to end my talk with. For me, maybe the most important thing, like, I always would consider myself to be sort of the ugly duckling, you know, the only freak in town. I couldn't find people that were like-minded. But thanks to the internet, I get to not only correspond with like-minded people online, I get to meet them. And I get to share stuff with them, even if it's just to share the same room with them. And I think if we all put our energy and effort into finding out what is the most important thing to change first in copyright law, like I'm currently focusing on intermediary protections, if we can figure out what can we all put our effort in so that we're not always on the run. You know, so we're not always reactionary, so we can be a step ahead of them. And IMMI, the Icelandic Modern Media Initiative, when we did that, and you can have a look at it at en.immi.is, the initiative itself, the idea was basically to go and cherry pick all the best laws to ensure, you know, a proper 21st century solution to freedom of information, expression, speech, and privacy. If we can pull together a template of what are the most pragmatic, important things to fix right now so we're not on the run, I think it would be tremendously useful. And I encourage you to think about that, and at the end of the conference, send an email to somebody that wants to receive all the emails or put it on the hashtag of the conference. Because we need to be very, we have to have a laser beam resolve and how we're going to solve these huge problems we're dealing with. I think Corey is really on something that's important, but I would really like to hear your thoughts about it. What is the single most important thing that we need to fix so that we're not always on the run in relation to these laws that we're dealing with? Thank you very much for listening.